I'm now going to introduce a very, very special speaker and our chief guest for the day. His name is R. Sriram. Sriram's passion for books is exemplary. He has established various bookstores. He started with Landmark in Chennai, set up Walden in Hyderabad, and then the Crossword chain. He co-founded Crossword with Ms. K. Anita in 1992 and helped build it into India's leading bookstore chain. He arranged for the buyout of Crossword by the current owner, Shoppers Stop, in 2000 from the initial investors, India Bookhouse Limited. He stepped down from Crossword Retail in August 2006 and co-founded Next Practice Retail, which offers business design, incubation and consulting services for consumer and retail businesses. Sriram is a passionate advocate of entrepreneurship and is the president of the Indus Entrepreneurs Mumbai, which is commonly known as DAI, the global non-profit organization that fosters entrepreneurship. He is an advisor to Seed Fund, the early stage venture fund, and to several of its investee companies, and is an independent director on the boards of Kokuyu Cameron Limited and Kokuyu Cameron Alpha Kids Limited. Sriram is equally passionate about social entrepreneurship and serves on the board of trustees of Non-Profit Society for Nutrition, Education and Health Action, known as SNEHA. That's for women and children in urban slums, and on the board of advisors for the non-profit Pratham Books that publishes affordable books for children in multiple Indian languages. Sriram has been a visiting faculty at the IIMA and a guest lecturer at the IIML and other business schools as it helps him keep learning. While at Crossword, Sriram established the Crossword Book Award, now known as the Vodafone Crossword Book Awards, to annually recognize and reward the best Indian writers and books, which he continues to oversee. He has curated the Kalagoda Literature Festival from 2005 to 2011. He remains a student and a book evangelist. May I request you to put your hands together and show a warm welcome to our special guest and keynote speaker for today, Mr. R. Sriram.
A very good morning to all of you. It is indeed my great pleasure and privilege to be here to share some of my thoughts with you today at the Print Summit 2012 with its very inspiring theme of making a difference. Join me in imagining this India. Our young, well-qualified workforce, the world's largest, powers India to new heights, while also playing a key role in the growing economies around the world. We have successfully solved the historic 3E problem, that of education, employability, and employment. We have succeeded in attracting talent and capital from around the world. India, therefore, accounts for 15% of the world's trade, progressing steadily to regain its past dominant position in global trade. India becomes a source of global innovations, new businesses, new technologies, new business models. Frugal with respect to capital and costs, innovative with respect to business models, as well as technology development and application, productive and responsive with regard to market needs. Indian scientists and economists routinely win Nobel Prizes for their achievements. Indian sportspersons win an increasing tally of medals at the Olympics. India has adopted happiness as a national goal and as a key indicator of well-being, learning from the experience of our neighbor, Kingdom of Bhutan. India's pluralistic and inclusive democracy, its diversity and tolerance is the benchmark to the world and a powerful moral force. Does this sound impossible? Well, consider this. India had the world's largest economy with a 33% share of global GDP in the first century CE. And again, in the 11th century, we had 29% share. More recently, in our own time, we have amazing examples of Indians who've done the seemingly impossible. Consider this scenario. You're 56 years old, just retired from a government job. You have severe rheumatoid arthritis. You have little money. you don't want to charge your customers anything in the new venture that you want to start. Can you build the world's largest enterprise in your domain? The answer is yes, you can. Dr. Govinda Pavakaswamy of Arvind Eye Care System did. Arvind is the largest and most productive eye care system in the world. They have treated over 32 million patients, performed over 3 million surgeries. Close to 70% of their patients are treated free of charge. They innovated almost every aspect of the business to transform productivity and costs. Inspired, Larry Page of Google went to Madurai to visit Dr. V. Arvind is required reading at Harvard Business School and many other institutions around the world. Now, how did Dr. V do this? By developing next practices that were game changers. India has the potential to be what we just imagined. But how do we get there? What are the principles that we start with? To quote the US computer scientist Alan Curtis Kay, the best way to predict the future is to invent it. Dr. C.K. Prahlad had detailed three principles that are simple yet powerful as a methodology for revitalizing India. They are, one, our aspirations must be greater than our resources. Two, we must progress towards our vision through a process of discovery by folding the future in. And three, we must innovate to develop next practices and change the game. The first principle relates to the essence of entrepreneurial transformation. Some will argue that we don't have the resources for the transformation that we have imagined. Every entrepreneur in this room knows that it is the tension between aspirations and resources that creates innovations and provides entrepreneurial energy. Indeed, one definition of entrepreneurship is that it is a pursuit of opportunity without regard to the resources currently controlled. As a country, India must have high shared aspirations. The last time this happened was in 1929, when we had a common aspiration for Purna Swaraj. There are only two ways to realize an aspiration that is greater than available resources. One is to leverage our resources and achieve greater productivity in all aspects. Alternatively, we can change the game to our advantage. That was Gandhi's genius. Not traditional armed struggle against the British, but peaceful satyagraha. More recently, Arvind Hospitals changed the game with severely limited resources, bringing down the cost of the intraocular lens that they used to import at $100 down to a few $. They have since supplied these lenses to over 85 countries, with non-profits paying $4 and for-profits paying all of $8. Varaprasad Reddy of Shanta Biotech changed the game with regard to hepatitis B vaccine by developing it from scratch in India and crashing the prices from rupees 750 in 1991 to rupees 15 today. The number of people vaccinated grew from 80,000 in 1991 to over 100 million in 2008, thanks to his efforts. Dainik Bhaskar, a name that all of us here are familiar with, innovated a way to become the number one newspaper on day of launch, time and again, a feat never achieved by anyone in the world. There are powerful stories of how 11 Indians pulled off the impossible in Porus Munshi's fascinating book, making breakthrough innovations happen. Two other recent books published by Harvard Business Press, The India Way and India Inside, describe innovative Indian practices. Our second principle is to realize that we cannot achieve our potential by extrapolating what we have done so far. We have to visualize our potential and then fold that future in to determine our actions today as well as the road ahead through a process of discovery and experimentation. Third, we cannot focus on best practices. To innovate, we need to focus on and develop next practices that change the game. We have an amazing number of inspiring examples of Indians who achieved this with severely limited resources. What we need is a bold vision and pursue it with belief and passion to achieve game-changing innovation. If your question now is, how can I make a difference to realize that dream, to realize that vision that we've imagined? The answer is that as entrepreneurs, you're already making a big difference. Since job number one for India is job creation. But there are numerous other ways. But I will focus on one of them. As an experienced entrepreneur and leader, you can help foster entrepreneurs and entrepreneurship. You can also seed and support many new enterprises. We need upwards of 1 million new entrepreneurs every year in India. Given that we have 360 million children below the age of 14 in India, 20% of the world's children live in our country. As they enter the job market over the next two decades, we need job creation on a massive scale. To illustrate the acute scarcity of jobs, I would like to draw your attention to State Bank of India's advertisement for 11,000 clerical jobs a little over a year and a half ago. Any guesses as to how many people applied for 11,000 vacancies? Sorry? 5 lakhs? It's actually 34 lakhs. 3.4 million people applied for 11,000 jobs. Currently, all of corporate India employs less than 12 million people. The government of India employs some 20 million people. And that's why everyone wants to work with the government. There are some 26 million small family-owned enterprises in India that employ nearly 60 million people, next to only the agricultural sector. These entrepreneurs account for 45% of the manufactured output and 8% of GDP, according to RBI's 2010 figures. They are the real heroes of Indian economy. But even when you add up all three, we have too few jobs for a country that has a workforce of 500 million people. The good news is that in the next 15 to 18 years, India's GDP is set to quadruple even at fairly low growth rates of 6.5% or 7%, resulting in the net addition of some $4.5 trillion. An important feature of our economy is that private domestic consumption accounts for close to 60% of our GDP, as opposed to less than 40% for China. By 2020, final private domestic consumption is estimated to grow to $3.6 trillion from $800 billion in 2010. The whole world is eyeing or entering the Indian market, which will be the engine of growth for many of the global businesses over the next decade or more. The question is, are Indian entrepreneurs going to seize this unprecedented opportunity or allow global corporations to do so? The reality is that India is fundamentally different from developed markets and will not evolve in the same way. Consider the leapfrogging achieved by our telecom and banking sectors. The Indian market, while large and diverse, is akin to a varied continent like Europe, and not a uniform country in terms of geography, language, culture, purchasing power, as well as political views. The consumer in India is also evolving rapidly, with her needs, attitudes, and perceptions undergoing sea changes. These present both challenges and opportunities for entrepreneurs, and those who are able to innovate and deliver relevant solutions and achieve requisite scale will be handsomely rewarded. Indian entrepreneurs have two great parents in necessity and scarcity as our mothers and fathers, who spur frugal innovation, a clear advantage in today's world. Apart from the opportunities in India, we will also see very significant opportunities for us globally, both in developed markets and developing ones. The former could be in acquisitions, and a strong trend has already emerged of Indian businesses, big and small, acquiring businesses much bigger than themselves in developed markets. The latter opportunity is in developing markets for high quality, frugal solutions that we are particularly well placed to serve. I volunteer at Thai Mumbai, as you heard. I happen to be the current president because I'm passionate about the need to foster entrepreneurs and entrepreneurship. We fulfill our mission through a variety of programs that we deliver throughout the year to enable access to success to entrepreneurs. At two recent Thai Enterprising India summits, we've had the privilege of hosting an amazing range of innovative Indians who demonstrate what is possible across a wide spectrum of industries and geographies. InMobi, that was founded in 2007, has in four fast years grown to be the world's largest independent mobile advertising network. Carvale, India's largest auto media vehicle, was launched in October 2005 and acquired by Axel Springer and the India Today Group in 2010, just 5 years later, creating far greater enterprise value than a traditional print business. Contrast this with the sale of the once iconic 77-year-old brand Newsweek for all of US$1, plus huge financial liabilities for the buyer. Redbus, that offers bus tickets through the net, mobile or home delivery, services more than 10,000 routes and serviced 4.25 million passengers in 2011. They featured in Fast Company's 50 most innovative companies from around the world. On another note, Ramaswamy Ilango is engineering social scale on a national level after transforming his village Kuttambakkam in Tamil Nadu with community integrated housing, indigenous industry, Gram Swaraj, equality, equal wages for women, apart from the basics of good roads, electricity, drinking water, and a school. Howard Schultz, the chairman of Starbucks, has eloquently conveyed what one needs to do to succeed in any endeavor. He said, "Care more than others think wise. Risk more than others think safe. Dream more than others think practical. Expect more than others think possible." The four C's of curiosity, creativity, confidence, and character are all hallmarks of successful entrepreneurs and leaders. The aim of every enterprise is to create and deliver value and sustain this profitably. However, over 90% of all businesses are in the better business game. In a crowded marketplace teeming with similar businesses, they seek to deliver incrementally better value propositions. They are serving customer needs that are already well served and end up in a red ocean. Some refuse to join this madness and work to innovate to deliver and sustain a different value proposition. They are serving customers' unserved needs and they're able to find a good niche. Game changers develop radical innovation and deliver new value propositions that redefine the industry. They're able to see markets through new eyes and identify key needs of customers that customers often don't or can't articulate, and serve this in a manner that others don't or won't or can't. Innovation is therefore vital to thrive and prevail. The Monitor Group has identified 10 types of innovation across the four areas of business model, business process, solution offering, and delivery. While most companies focus on the solution or product offering, the most successful innovations are seen across business model and value delivery. The last involves brand and the customer experience. Some of the questions we need to answer are, have we chosen and sized our market opportunity well? How big is our dream? How large is our vision? Do we want to just survive? Do we want to thrive? Or do we want to change the game? How well do we understand the forces impacting our industry, our business? The reality is that disruptive competition is often from innovators in other industries, not ours. What insights do we have about customers and their businesses? This is vital. As our customers' businesses are disrupted, so will ours. What are the key trends that we can envisage? Have we spent time understanding possible impact on our business? What foresight do we have about our customers and markets, technologies and business models, about mobility and digitization, about the intersection of all these? Have we built our organizations, our cultures, and our teams to confidently navigate the choppy waters that lead to unprecedented opportunities? Do we have able boards that will help us realize our potential? Do we have advisory boards that help us ask the right questions? We will profit immensely by obsessing on all of these. To help think through some trends that are likely to impact us, I would suggest that you Google Future Agenda Program. There is a free ebook on the world in 2020 available at www.futureagenda.org. I'm involved in a similar Indian project called Future Sites India, and we are currently engaged in raising funds for this. To thrive and prevail, we must build strong, sustainable brands. Have we built one? Or are we building one? A good brand represents trust, consistency, reliability, and dependability that its customers and stakeholders value. It's the dynamic sum of the experience it delivers. Great brands appeal at the rational, emotional, and psychological levels, in tangible and intangible ways. While developing a brand, we need to choose the brand name with care, keeping in mind its denotative and connotative meanings, as well as how well it translates into other relevant languages. The right name should fit with the following five brand attributes. It should personify the value proposition well. It should fit with our brand values. It should be distinctive, original, memorable. It should appeal to the target audience and stakeholders. And finally, it must be easy to pronounce and recall. To create trust and loyalty, a good brand must essentially improve the lives of its customers. If not, it doesn't deserve to exist. Transformational leadership is vitally needed now to progress towards all that we have visualized. When we talk about leadership, we often tend to define it within a specific sphere, usually that of work. Managers operate from a position of authority within a hierarchy and are usually ineffective without the position. But leadership is a behavior, not a position. Good leaders are effective in all spheres, in the home and family, in the neighborhood and community, in the enterprise and outside, in the nation and the world. They are the change that they want to see. They possess the vital three P's four E's and two A's. They operate with a clear sense of purpose that they articulate. They are passionate and principled. They have high energy as well as the ability to energize. They have the domain edge and the ability to execute. And importantly, they have high level of empathy. They also have the ability to articulate and amplify what is important. Purpose is at the heart of leadership. Our purpose defines who we are and what we do with our lives. Thinkers over the years have proposed various motives for human purpose. Freud believed in the will to pleasure, while Adler believed in the will to power as the force that drives human actions. But Viktor Frankl believed that the will to meaning provides central purpose to human life. This resonates powerfully for me. Finding and providing meaning is the central task of leadership. And this starts with voyaging within. For only when the leader finds meaning in her life, can she connect with others and their meaning. As the Tao Te Ching states, knowing others is wisdom. Knowing the self is enlightenment. Mastering others requires force. Mastering the self needs strength. Great leaders are self-referral rather than object-referral. They define themselves on who they are and what they do rather than what they have or what they have built. There are many critical questions that leaders ask themselves. Who am I? Why do I exist? What is my purpose? What is my aspiration? What do I want to be? What will I do with my life? What value will I deliver? What do I believe in? And how will I behave? And how will I make a difference? The most common characteristic of good, memorable leaders is that they create the conditions for people to be encouraged, challenged, and supported. If each of us were to follow typical Western lifestyles, we will need six Earths, and we have but one. Our modern production and consumption methods are not sustainable. We must find and adopt ways of living and growing that will be. India had the world's largest economy in the first century. And during the 17th century too, India's share was 24%, more than all of Western Europe. But in the 60s, this came down to 0.5%. And it now stands at 2.5%. It is now time for us to regain that share that we once had, not once, but twice. And India's demographics and market economics, as well